I've been doing my mic placement right and yet wrong this whole time. Let's talk about that. Tim Tippets, aka VO Tech Guru, went live in his course's Facebook group to share the truth about mic placement. The session was so mind-blowing, so I asked for his permission to share that info on this channel, and he said yes. He'll have the original version of the video up on his channel in the future. But with his permission, I'm going to share the gist of what he said non-verbatim.
I obviously don't sound like Tim Tippets and won't capture his tone, but this is essentially what he said.
I'll also share my personal thoughts afterwards. Just a disclaimer that this is not a dig at anyone's mic placement. If you have mic placement that's been working for you, congratulations. But this is some really good stuff, so you might want to consider it. Now for the demo. For the sake of this test, I'm going to handhold this AT2020 Vision Edition XLR, but please do not do that because it's got a lot of handling noise. It's not designed for that. And my goodness, it is a fingerprint magnet. So Tim said that we're taught to place the microphone somewhere over here, which is overhead, facing the forehead, and this is my addendum. Maybe like a finger spread distance. Some say it's about 15 inches. And it's true that people say that because I've been told that again and again. I've been to many studios that actually recommend this, and that's what I do in the studio. So this is what I meant by I've been doing my mic placement right. Now let me introduce you to the microphone's eardrum, also known as the diaphragm. Let me just grab my phone. Harry Potter fans are gonna love this. Lumos! Ta-da! Magic. So I'm gonna turn my light off for a bit so you can see this. Right there. That is the diaphragm, that circle in the middle. The way the diaphragm behaves is that wherever that circle is pointed at, that becomes the main source of the signal or the sound that the mic picks up. Now that we know what the diaphragm does, what I'm about to show you is the mic placement that Tim Tippets recommends. And with this mic placement, this is the amount of signal or volume that we're getting. So take out your hand from your pocket, then place the back of your thumb right here on your chin, and the mic's diaphragm, mouth level. Not facing upwards, because that'll cause you to sound nasally. Not facing downwards, because that doesn't sound good either. Mouth level. If you have tiny fingers like mine, use all 5 fingers, and if you have big sausage fingers, use 4 to measure distance. And that will be the distance between your mouth and the diaphragm, like so. What a lens is to a camera, that's what a diaphragm is to a microphone. And what you're seeing now is the visual equivalent of not having your diaphragm pointed at your mouth. So now the mic's closer, and isn't that so much better? You get a much fuller sound. But when it's right in front of you, and you might want to lower your volume for this, and you go, Peter Piper picked a peck of pickle, yeah, plosive tests are horrible. Totally didn't spit on it. Nope, not at all. Put a pop filter in front and go, Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. Better, but you still have some air bursting through. But even though pop filters aren't great for plosive rejection, Tim says that they're great for keeping saliva off your microphones. So how do we get rid of the plosives? Remember how the diaphragm works? It's like a laser beam firing at your mouth. This is where the magic happens. Take out your fingers again, turn a little bit to your right or left, about 40-45 degrees, and then face back to your script, and voila! That is magic. All of that plosive energy goes past your microphone and you can read your script. Now we sound fuller because the mic is so much closer and we get rid of the plosive issue because the mic is to the side, but we gotta do one last thing. And that is to enter another dimension known as the upside down. Ooh. Technically it's right side up. Okay, but why not have the mic upside down? Let's remember that we're reading from a script. So if we did it this way, diaphragm, mouth level, 40 to 45 degrees to the right or left, sounds great, but it's really blocking the script. Put it at the center, even worse. But if we flip it around, diaphragm, mouth level, 5-4 fingers depending on your finger size, 40 to 45 degrees to the right or left, and there you go. This is the final mic placement. Now check out our volume and see how much fuller that is compared to what we were doing earlier, which was this, see that? Look at the amplitude. It's so low. Night and day difference. Okay, some say it's supposed to be like this. Okay, there. Yeah, still no contest.
What this basically means is that because we're capturing the audio louder to begin with, we don't have to increase the volume as much in post. But how's that an advantage? Can't we just raise the volume of the audio in editing anyway?
To illustrate a point, I am going to step back from this microphone as far as I can. So now I'm recording this with a much weaker audio signal. And what you're going to hear now is the audio boosted in post. Can you hear that? Can you hear me talk? Now, because we're recording with really weak audio, we ended up boosting a lot of the background noise as well.
And that is why we want this lovely 4 to 5 finger distance from the mouth to the diaphragm.
But what about proximity effect?
So proximity effect is when you introduce extra bass when you're close to the mic. That's all it is. And according to Tim, this is the desired sound. We're supposed to sound like we're in someone's head.
I personally use proximity effect a lot.
Especially because I've got a scrawny voice.
In a world.
And that is the extent of my Don LaFontaine impression. But what about character work, Dave? This seems like it's for commercials. So I asked Tim, this seems like it's for commercial work. What about character work? And what he would do is retain that same mic placement, but he would reduce the gain. Okay, we're back on the Neumann U87, and just some final thoughts for me. For actual voiceover reads here at home or in the car, and I have to send that recording to a client, I would definitely use that mic placement that we were doing earlier. But if I'm working in a commercial studio, or I'm in any kind of live session with a client who knows what they're doing, and they have a preferred mic placement that isn't ridiculous, like speak from the back of your mic or something, then I'll follow their instructions. Depending on our relationship, then I might even recommend this mic placement. Now for YouTube, I'm going to follow the general principles of that mic placement. But I'm going to have the mic up here because whenever I put the mic down there and I do these hand gestures, I keep hitting the mic.
I'm sorry, baby. I won't hurt you ever again.
If you found this video helpful and you want to take your voiceover audio even a step further so you can book more work, go to dave.voiceactorsathome.com/audition-ready-audio. From there, you can access Tim Tippett's Audition Ready Online course. Ah, look at that. Welcome to Audition Ready Online. It's even got a free lesson on EQ that blew my mind and I finally understood what EQ was. And if you're ready to get the full course, click Get Started Now and create an account. Then on the checkout page, click Have a Coupon. And from there, type the code DS100 and click Apply. Voila, you get $100 off. If you enjoy this video, check out my studio tour.